Our next speaker is Dr. Fahad Nasir Alhazzani. He is a consultant neonatologist in King Faisal Hospital. He is certified in general pediatrics and neonatology and perinatal medicine from American Board of Pediatrics. He has done general pediatrics in McMaster University and neonatal perinatal medicine in McGill University, Canada. He has been a speaker in many national and international conferences, and I request Dr. Fahad to speak on probiotics in neonates. I would just like to make an announcement. Most of the audience here are females, and I think they are more than 95%. It's difficult to tell them to keep quiet if two ladies are sitting together, but please try to monitor the silence as much as you can, please. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much, Dr. Khan, Dr. Sanders. In the beginning, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to be a speaker in this wonderful conference. So what I'm going to talk about is the use of probiotics in the NICU, and this is mainly in preterm patients. So as we all know, the definition of probiotics, as the World Health Organization define it, is live microorganism, which when administered in adequate amount, confer health benefit to the host. These are bacteria that survive throughout the stomach and bile acids, adhere to the intestinal lining, and they establish a temporary residence in the intestinal host. So the type of probiotics that are used in the clinical trials are the lactobacillus, streptococcus, bifidobacterium, saccharomyces, and VCL number 3. Prebiotics, on the other hand, are the food for the probiotics. They are non-digestible food ingredients like the fructooligosaccharide and lactulose, and they positively affect the indigenous flora. They will stimulate the growth of a small number of bacterial species. Fructooligosaccharide is important for the bifidobacteria, while lactulose is important for lactobacillus. When you use symbiotics, it's like when you combine the organism and its food, so it's a combination of probiotics and prebiotics. In different fields of medicine, clinicians have done clinical trials to evaluate the effect of probiotics in different disease, and this is as recent as of 2006. So as you know, in infectious diarrhea, antibiotic-associated diarrhea, diarrhea prevention, inflammatory bowel disease, atopic disease, inflammatory bowel disease, and H. pylori infection, and NIC, which one I'm going to speak about the most. So necrotizing enterocolitis is the most important reason that the neonatologists have tested the use of probiotics. One of the other things that we wanted to know, whether probiotics will decrease the incidence of nosocomial sepsis and mortality. This is a picture of the intestinal wall of a preterm infant with NIC, and this is the air bubbles that you can see tracking through the blood vessels. So necrotizing enterocolitis is a significant cause of mortality and morbidity. It affects anywhere between 7 to 10% of very low birth weight infant. Unfortunately, we don't know what's the exact cause. It's a multifactorial disease. And the current understanding right now that it is the single final pathway created by various injury, like the mucosal damage, ischemia, hypoxia, increased osmolarity from enteral feeding, and the presence of potentially invasive bacteria. This is one of the models for the pathogenesis of NIC. What you have is that this is the liminal bacteria, and this is the TL4 receptor. You have an inciting event like stress, hypoxia, infection, and prematurity, and the organism will gain access, where they will trigger an inflammatory pathway that will ultimately end up in the full-blown picture of NIC. It's a complex disease with multifactorial pathogenesis, and when we try to prevent it, several clinical trials have been done, testing several treatments, and unfortunately, most of these trials were negative. Nothing was really effective. What we know that is really proving is feeding fresh human breast milk as the most important thing that we can use to prevent NIC. Unfortunately, as you're aware, it's not always possible to use breast milk for several various reasons. In the past, people have used antibiotics and changing the feeding practice, but that was not clear. So if we need to understand, as we said, that the first step of NIC is the mucosal injury. And the mucosal injury will give access to the colonization by the pathogenic bacteria. If we look at the breastfed infant, they have two predominant bacteria in their stool, bifidobacterium and lactobacillus, which is the same as the antibiotics. While babies who receive formula feeding, they get the coliform, the enterococcus, the bacteroids, which are really the bad guys. And in preterm infants, the problem is even worse. They get exposed to various factors that are not the same as a term infant, and they are colonized by less than 3 species by the 10th day of life. And the problem is that the good bacteria, like the bifidobacterium and lactobacillus, are found only less than 5%. So the proposed mechanism that probiotics will be effective in NIC is promote gut colonization with beneficial organism, decrease colonization of the pathogenic organism, improve the gut maturity and function, and modulate the immune system like the TL4 receptor and the inflammatory cytokines. So the question that we have, and we have to analyze it in an evidence-based fashion, is first, is probiotic safe to be used in preterm infant? And two, is it effective in decreasing NIC, sepsis, and mortality? So this is the first trial that we're going to look at. This was a trial that was done in Jerusalem. It involved 72 infants who were very low birth weight, and they were given a mixed probiotic, lactobacillus, streptococcus, and bifidobacterium. The control group, they received either EBM, express breast milk, or preterm formula, and the primary outcome was NIC. It is interesting that this was a single-center study that was published in 2003 and 2005 in abstract form, and at that time it was reported with different inclusion and exclusion criteria and different outcome. This study was shown a significant reduction in the incidence of NIC, 4% compared to 16%. However, sepsis and mortality were not significant. The second study that was published 2 years before that one was done in Greece, and it had also a small number of patients, 51 babies, and they used a single species of probiotics, which is the Saccharomyces boulardii. And the primary outcome of this study was not NIC or sepsis or mortality. It was just the gut function and stool colonization, and NIC was reported as a secondary outcome. So NIC and sepsis were not significant, and the conclusion of that study that when probiotics were used, the stool flora was closer to breastfed infants. So we have one positive study and one negative study, and both of them are small studies with some methodological issues. The third one is a large study that was done by Carlo Dani in Italy. It involved 7 NICUs in Italy. They have a large number of patients, almost 300 patients. So the probiotics group, they received the standard milk, which is either breast milk or formula, and they were given lactobacillus once a day till discharge. The primary outcome was a composite of UTI, sepsis, and NIC, and the study did not show any significant difference. The interesting part in this study is that the incidence of NIC and sepsis was very, very, very low in both groups. The incidence of NIC in that study was about 1%, while the incidence of NIC in like large centers in the United States, like the NICHD, is around 7 to 10%. The last study in the first era, which is 2002 to 2005, was a study that was done in Taiwan. It was a well-designed study, and it has a good number of patients, 180 in each arm. What they used in that study is enfloran, which is lactobacillus, acidophilus, and bifidobacterium infantis. They used it twice a day with express plus milk till discharge. What is interesting in this study is that this study was restricted only to breast milk. If they don't have the maternal breast milk, they would use a donor breast milk. And they have what they call the breast milk team, who are a team that practice outside the NICU. They will handle the milk, they will add the probiotics, but they don't know which baby will receive it. The primary outcome in this study was death or NIC. So this study was really impressive, as it showed a significant reduction in death or NIC, and even culture-proven sepsis. So overall, this was a large study that was well-designed, that was positive. The next study that was done after that was done by Dr. Manzoni in Italy. It was a quite small study, and they used 2 species of probiotics, and the primary outcome was the incidence of fungal colonization, and NIC was a secondary outcome. So they were doing samples from the mouth, from the gastric aspirate, from the rectum and stool for fungus. This study showed that the fungal colonization was significantly reduced. However, sepsis and NIC is not reduced. In some parts of the world, the risk of fungal sepsis in very low birth weight infants is quite high. And it has been shown that once you decrease the colonization, you can decrease sepsis. But it was not shown in this study, and probably because it was a small number of babies. So none of these studies have reported systemic infection caused by probiotics. So the conclusion from these studies that it was safe in that small number of patients. However, none of the studies have reported long-term outcome, and none of these studies reported the highest risk group of NIC, which are the extremely low birth weight infant or infants with birth weight below 1,000 gram. This is a summary of these studies, and you can see the difference in probiotics that were used, and the difference of breast milk. And this is a major confounder because breast milk is very effective at reducing NIC. Breast milk can decrease the incidence of NIC by 6 times compared to formula. So all these trials were analyzed in a systematic review that was published in the Cochrane Library by Dr. Al-Faleh. It included the 4 studies, and this is the outcome of interest, which is necrotizing enterocolitis, and it was significantly reduced when you combine the studies together. All-cause mortality, there was a significant reduction, and NIC-related mortality was not significantly different, but there was a good trend. Sepsis has not been shown to be reduced by the use of probiotics, and when you combine them together, death or NIC or sepsis, you get the outcome from the one study, which was the study from Taiwan. What was the other interesting part is that you assume when you give probiotics, you decrease the incidence of NIC, you improve gut colonization, and that the oral tolerance or the enteral feeding will improve. However, the trend was in favor of the control group. So the conclusion in that Cochrane review that probiotics reduce the risk of severe NIC and mortality in preterm infant, but we don't have enough data on extremely low birth weight infant, and there was no evidence of significant reduction of nosocomial sepsis. In the last 3 years, what happened is that there were 4 more trials, and they had a large number of patients. There was another systematic review that was done, and then we had more questions. So the first trial was a small trial that was done in Greece, and it has a small number of patients, and the primary outcome was not NIC. It was about the intestinal permeability. That study showed that when you use probiotic, you can improve the intestinal permeability. NIC was, there was 0 cases in one arm and 3 cases in the other arm, but this was a too small study to come with a conclusion. The second one, the same group from Taiwan, what did they do this time is that instead of doing a single center study, they've used 7 centers. They used the same compound, which was the enfluran, and they used the same primary outcome, which was death or NIC. And they have shown again that when you use probiotics, death or NIC, and NIC was significantly reduced. And what they show is that death or NIC was even lower in infants weighing 500 to 750 grams, which was the first time somebody was able to show that. However, in the probiotic group, the incidence of sepsis was higher, almost 20%. And when they adjusted for other confounding variables, that difference has disappeared. This was another study that was done in 2 centers in France. It was a small study, but they used 2 strains of antibiotic and maltodextrin as the prebiotic, and they were trying to look at the incidence of enteral tolerance. And this trial was stopped early because when they did sequential analysis, they could not find any beneficial effect. This study was published last year. It was done in India. They had 91 infants in the control group, and they used 4 strains of antibiotic. And they had a composite outcome, including NIC, and that study again showed a significant reduction in NIC, death, sepsis, or NIC. So early this year, around May, there was a systematic review that was done in pediatric that combined all the trials together, and it has shown that the incidence of NIC was reduced when you use probiotics. Same conclusion with sepsis. Probiotics did not decrease the incidence of sepsis, and mortality was reduced in this one. This systematic review was interesting, and what was even more interesting is that the recommendation that came from it is that additional placebo-controlled trials are unnecessary if we have the suitable probiotics product. Well, do we have enough evidence? Should we stop doing enough trials on probiotics because of that systematic review? Well, some people believe so, and some people did not. This was a comment that was published in the same issue from Australia, and that comment was asking people, why are we not using the probiotics yet, why we have the reservation? And what that comment was suggesting is that probiotics reduce mortality, it's as conclusive as surfactant for respiratory distress syndrome. And for the neonatologist, like surfactant, we know that it has been very, very well studied and very well proven to decrease mortality. And finally, the Dr. Tornamordi was saying that history may not judge us kindly if we ignore the probiotics. Well, Joseph New did not seem to agree with that comment, and they raised several concerns with that meta-analysis, with flaws and lack of information initial studies. And again, the incidence of sepsis in the big trial, the Lynn trial, was quite concerning. And what he was suggesting is that we need a large number of study with different probiotic regimen. He was concerned that there is no FDA approval for probiotics in the U.S., and one of the problems is that none of the trials, as you can see, was done in the U.S. So he was suggesting to use a more cautious approach. Roger Saul again agreed that probiotics might be effective, but we have to get more data on the extremely low birth weight infant. And he commented that we have 10 different studies, and each of them that they use the different probiotics, and most important confounding factor, which is the breast milk, was not controlled for in these studies. Now, why is the big fuss with probiotics compared to the other treatments? Is that when you give a medication, you give it to the patient, half-life of the drug will go away. With probiotics, no. It's going to stay there. It's going to propagate within the host, and it's going to have a long-term effect. And on the other hand, when you give live organism in the NICU, which is an area where patients are immune compromised, there can be a cross-colonization to the other babies. As a concern, that sepsis has been reported in adults who were immune suppressed prior to surgery, but we don't know in the future if we use probiotics, are we going to see any routine cases or not. Now, we have main concerns with the extremely low birth weight infant. We don't know the optimum type or dose, and we don't know what the long-term effect. Now, what does the future has for us? These are the ongoing trials right now that, as you can see, has a very large number of patients, and most of them will be completed soon within the next year or 2 years. Hopefully, by the time that these trials are completed and published, then we will know and we'll have more data. Thank you very much.